crime.
Maybe he is just a criminal committing a horrible crime, Douglas Murray, and the fact that there was this assumption that he was somehow linked to Islamic State clearly made a great amount of that by saying he was one of their soldiers. Aren't we playing into their hands?
Well, the reason why people assumed that he was doing this, at least was inspired by Islamic State, is because it's something that Islamic State has called upon people around the world to do, using exactly this sort of methodology. Islamic State has said for some years that since various cells in the West have found it very hard to get hold of the technology to make bombs in recent years, they've been disrupted from doing so. Since it's very hard in the UK, for instance, to get hold of Kalashnikov rifles, ISIS has called on people in countries like this who follow their message to carry out attacks using vehicles, very low-grade attacks, knives, you know, this sort of thing. So that's why it fits a pattern of ISIS-inspired attacks. So we'll find out exactly, or some more of what motivated him in the days and weeks and months to come. As for the question of publicity, this is a huge question which we're always wondering about. This was a good week, after all, wasn't it, to wonder about terrorism and our attitude towards it in general. Martin McGuinness, I think, responsible for more deaths than anybody else in the UK in recent decades, died and was eulogised in the House of Commons. 24 hours later, the House of Commons was attacked by another type of terrorism. But I think this is a very bad sign for this country. The way in which we treat terrorists of the past tells us how we will treat terrorists of the future. I'm glad that was such a powerful point in the studio, but
yeah, listen, Douglas, you have your fans.
But this I think should really worry us. During the IRA's campaign, people said we would never give in to terror. All MPs, policemen, and others all said the same thing again this week. But the record shows in this country that we can give in to terror and have, and so. You know, the whole issue of media coverage, as it were, by comparison with that fundamental societal problem, is relatively easy to solve.
So we're playing their game.
That's
the photograph of the woman with the hijab on social media crossing Westminster Bridge.
Yeah.
And from afar, it looked like she was ignoring the tragedy unfolding
yes.
around her
yeah.
and being, you know, heartless. But if you actually looked at the closer photograph, it was of her face.
Yeah.
She was extremely distraught, and she was possibly phoning for help, obviously. Phoning to tell
she's issued a statement.
Her friends
I don't
and family.
Know if you're familiar, but she's issued a statement.
Yeah,
she has issued a statement, and the photographers actually released the other photographs yeah. around.
She
that
had helped people.
Image.
Indeed, so.
I think anybody in that frame of mind, at that position, I can't imagine anybody walking away from something like no. that. That's not a sense of humanity.
So, Douglas, this is huge. Don't you think, Douglas, this is hugely counterproductive, because then you are adding to the feeling in communities that they are being persecuted and they are being stigmatized, and then that adds to their agenda mm. that the demonization of Britain. So it's a
sure.
it's a feedback loop, isn't it?
But I don't think we've got into that. I don't think that's been what's happening. I think it's been very
has it been happening?
I think it's been very
it hasn't been huge statements.
What are you talking about the EDL for? I mean, I'm talking about our society as a whole, okay? Mm. In our society as a whole and our media as a whole, there has not been any crazy response to this. The media, by and large, has done its job. It's been fairly restrained. I agree there is a time, definitely, for all of the discussions that have come up already. By the way, quickly on this thing about motive, and I think we shouldn't attribute motive until we know, but we should certainly look into the cases where drugs have been involved. I think it's long overdue to consider that. I also think we're long overdue to consider the role that religion can play in these attacks as well. These are not mutually exclusive. You know, there are many people who have carried out Islamist attacks who have been, you know, eating pork, drinking and so on, and then do what they do precisely as an act of, as it were, religious purification. That's very common. So these things are not, I mean, the 9/11 hijackers went to strip bars and all that kind of thing. You know, I mean, these things are not exclusive. They're a very, very complex picture that leads somebody to carry out this sort of thing. But, you know, we should be having a wide-ranging discussion on it. Thankfully, on this programme, we can. But quite often in our media and elsewhere, we don't have as wide-ranging a discussion as we should. And our politicians in particular are clearly terrified of aspects of this discussion.
We're open, we're honest, we have a frank exchange of views. What are our politicians scared of saying?
Well, first of all, they're scared of saying, actually, you know, the amount of people proclaiming this week, you know, we will not allow this to change our society. I mean, who on earth thought it would? I mean, who thought that a guy with a knife and a car was going to bring down British democracy and cause the Queen to abdicate and put the flag of Islam over Buckingham Palace?
But,
I mean,
Douglas, one of the things which has happened ever since the terrorist attacks during the Blair era is that governments have used these attacks as a pretext to take away important liberties. Yeah. And Benjamin Franklin said long ago that if you sacrifice your liberty for temporary security, you'll end up having neither liberty nor security. But our governments have flagrantly ignored this. Longer detention periods without trial, more intrusion, more snooping.
Is that a danger, Douglas?
This has changed our society. What politicians are very much afraid of is that people will discover how very little power they have to prevent these attacks, far less than they pretend that they have, and that they actually cannot do the things they claim to do.
I don't think Douglas is quite finished. What do you think about what we heard from so many people? We will not be cowed. What did you think about that?
It's a very good thing that people think that and say that. But I mean, I think some of the response to this, I mean, this was not the Blitz. This was not a sustained night after night campaign. It was one attack, a brutal, horrible attack in the heart of London. But to that extent, sort of emotionally, and I agree with what Peter wrote this morning, we have to be careful not to be overreacting.
A policeman was killed, and when a policeman is killed, Keith Palmer, it always strikes at the heart, doesn't it?
And our society has said very clearly.
But Nicky, a lot of us here lived through the IRA bombing campaigns in London. We remember piles of dead horses and indeed dead human beings in Hyde Park and Regent's Park on the same day. Actually, we didn't go into lockdown or half-mast or minute silence mode then. We thought, all right, these people are our enemies, we will put up with it. Our government were the ones who let us down by literally giving in to IRA bombers and giving them pretty much all that they wanted and going to Martin McGuinness's funeral.
They're actually contradicting what they're saying.
Who is?
Douglas. Because on the one hand, you're saying, look, we don't want to cower to the terrorists, we don't want to be singing their agenda, and yet the first thing everybody uses is the word Islam. Well, listen, in this particular state, I was actually in Scotland Yard on this case, so I was there on the day. To qualify as an Islamist incident, it has to fit a certain criteria. And it was discussed earlier on, but no one actually mentioned why this was classed and why it was taken over by SO 15 as an Islamic incident. Otherwise, it would have just been homicide that would have taken over this case. There are certain criteria. For instance, if he said the word Allahu Akbar, that would have been clearly an Islamist incident. If he had a flag of ISIS, clearly it would have been Islamic. He didn't have any of those. He didn't say anything. He didn't leave a note. The only thing that makes this a counter-terrorism...
He was a Muslim.
No, not even that. It was because he wasn't... We don't know if he was a practicing Muslim, because he clearly wasn't a very good Muslim.
What does a very good Muslim mean?
Well, if he's into... He was taking cocaine. He was into... wife bashing, all those things. If he was a Muslim, he wouldn't be taking cocaine and having, drinking alcohol. But it was because he attacked. Let me just finish the point. The reason was because he attacked a political institution, the heart of government. That was one of the reasons, if you like, that qualified it. He's in terms of practicing, that's still coming out. We don't know whether...
Well, you've just said what you think. You've just given us your view, which is that it's nothing to do with Islam. And other people will have a view that it is. But I'm suggesting that as a society, we actually take the time to work out people's motives. But it's very clear that in your case, for instance, you wouldn't want it to be ascribed to an Islamic motive. Even if it was turned out that he had a copy of the Quran in the car, you would say it had nothing to do with Islam.
We would have accepted
that. There are people, let me finish the point, and there are people who would say it has something to do with Islam, even if it's very clear that it has nothing to do with Islam. But there are, in this whole thing, my simple point is that we should be looking at the motives, and at the moment there are parts of the anti-terrorism and counter-extremism strategy where the government is, and politicians are very worried about treading on it. And you saw it, as was mentioned earlier, in Theresa May's comments in the House this week, where she immediately ruled one aspect of this whole thing out.
You seem to be quite hung up on the fact that this is a Quranic scriptural point.
Scriptures are open to interpretation,
and literalists. If they're not quoting scripture, why are we bringing scripture into this? Because a lot of them quote
the verses that say, find the interval in infidels,
no,
root them
don't.
Out and kill
this
them.
No, they don't.
Douglas wanted to come in.
Come on. This is a great example of it right here. Miss Al-Andalusi thinks that none of the terrorists ever quote the Quran. Flat out wrong. flat-out wrong. Let me give you one example. You mentioned it earlier, the killers of Lee Rigby. Michael Adelaggio, on his body, when the police arrested him, he had a note in his pocket to his young daughter explaining why he did what he did. It's all on the public record. You can see the facsimile on the BBC's website. And he has footnotes throughout it of Quranic verses that he explains justify, in his view, his actions. Now, that's the beginning. Let me just finish my point. That would seem to me to be, therefore, a very clear occasion, never mind the thousands of others we could list worldwide, a very clear occasion on this country when one of our soldiers was murdered on our streets, where clearly scripture had something to do with it. So the problem that a lot of us have is we are willing to discuss the drugs bit, we're willing to discuss the foreign policy bit, we're willing to discuss all this. Why are you not willing to concede that there is a religious element? Sometimes.
Wait.
Obviously, 24-hour news pushes a lot of this. Obviously, there's a lot of speculation because we have the 24-hour news culture. However, there are things about that that are unhealthy. But it's nothing like as unhealthy as the fact that if you look back, as I said at the start, about our attitude to terror of the past and our attitude to terror present, when the IRA killed MPs and many policemen and many soldiers, what did we end up doing? We ended up putting the people who had orchestrated that campaign at the heart of government. And that is far sicker. The idea that 20 years from now, anyone who was associated with Khalid Massoud would be put into power, that's far more of a societal sickness than 24-hour news media. It's a fascinating discussion. I mean, you put a very hard case of a priest in a confessional knowing about a paedophile. If I can say, if to widen that out a bit, consider the number of people in our society who haven't sworn that they would keep secrets, but have done. For personal reasons, community reasons, or social reasons. Look at the number of people who must have known, for instance, about Jimmy Savile's abuse. And they kept silent, not because they were sworn to by something, but because they felt the pressure of it. Mm-hmm. So it's quite easy to sort of think of this as being a sort of the hardest problem for a Catholic priest. Actually, it's a society. A lot of people in our society cover over things whilst moralising about things like Catholic priests.
And as a practising Catholic, one does wonder what might have been revealed in the confessional when he was in church. Yeah.